Finance 2.0 to Aspire 1.0 will also be an interesting transition. A housing finance company builds a 2,000 crore book in what, 2 years? And arguably as stable as any there is in the land. We are skeptical, and maybe you will address some of this skepticism. Let me welcome Adil Sachidananda.
Good afternoon, everyone. I don't have any presentation. I'm a practitioner. I've spent all my life doing home finance. So I thought that I will come in here, speak about whatever I know, whatever we have been doing in Aspire, and solicit any questions that comes out from you, and try to respond to any of the questions that comes to the best of my knowledge. Having said so, Aspire was born 27 months back. Sponsored by Motilal Oswal Group. The journey of Aspire began like any professional sitting here, and many of us who are grayed our hair, we blacken, so we don't look that old. But many of us who are grayed our hair have one thing in common. We all see a lot of cash flows. As we grow in life, 25 saal ke journey mein, corporate life ke journey mein, pagar badhte jata hai. As he said, 80% bonus to mili jata hai. So pagar badhte jata hai, but we don't see the cash, we don't see the fun flow. And in the end, when there is an aspiration for someone to create, to become an entrepreneur, then they have to go and knock the doors. And that is what I did, by knocking the door of Motilal ji and Ramdev ji. And that's where I met Motilal ji and Ramdev ji, and got the initial investment of 100 crores to start Aspire Home Finance 27 months back. Few things that went into the creation of Aspire, and few things that made us build Aspire the way it is today. And I'm sure Dipen should be a skeptical. Yes, there has to be skepticism for the kind of numbers that got built. But when we look back at the journey of Aspire, when we look back to the journey of Aspire to what it is today in the last 27 months, I think I will break that journey into three parts. So journey number one is pre-start of the company. Journey number two is how we build the first phase, and version two of Aspire, which we are building now. So when we started off with a very clear vision of capital, and for any professional, for any young or old professionals, the visibility of capital is very, very important, and that's what the sponsors showed us. In their initial deliberation, they showed us the visibility of capital of 100 crores to start a home finance company. And then the sidelines of discussion to start a company and the process of starting a company was very, very critical. It was very clear in the mind of management, or at that time it was I, and it became we, that we want to run and build a good governed organization, which means that we have to have some of those things which we will not practice, which can through a small line of difference between a good governance and an average governance. So for which we have to build a good board, for which we have to have a great audit team, for which we have to have certain ways and methods of doing things with discipline and consistently doing things year, month on month, year on year, quarter on quarter, irrespective of how we would be looked at, and then establish ourselves over a period of time. And that is what went well. So 100 crores of capital, deciding to look for an auditor and engaging with KPMG as our auditor. It's very easy when we look back, when we stand here and say we had KPMG. Because when you are part of a group, a typical group auditor tends to shake hands and want to become an auditor. But to say no to this auditor and to hire KPMG or to get KPMG becomes a difficult thing, and for which sponsors and management team has to take that decision. And knowing some of those big four firms who has a right to write on the audit report, notes on accounts, make some of our practitioners a little skeptical when we look at whom we should look at our auditors. So having said so, we had those aspects of governance kept in mind. Capital being in place, it was very, very important to have a very focus on what we wanted. Very clearly, as a practitioner, I always wanted to create a small ticket of home finance ecosystem that will kind of insulate ourselves from any other part of home finance. So while the regulatory arbitrage allows us to do non-housing finance, somewhere in my mind, as a professional, as a home finance professional, I was very clear with the sponsoring team that we won't do anything called non-housing finance. And thankfully, 27 months have passed and we have not even touched a single unit of non-housing finance. And that's perhaps one of the success stories on which we built. That becomes a the focus area for the management, technology, processes, all that we wanted to build. So we were very clear that we will only and only do retail home finance. Within the retail home finance, we wanted to look at what we are likely to do, and we wanted to do small ticket home finance. Within the small ticket home finance, we again wanted to look at which geography we wanted to go, and we looked at the geographies where there are concentration of housing in that range between 5 lakhs to 25 lakhs. So within the system and DNA and ecosystem, we built an operating philosophy which limited ourselves to loan up to 25 lakhs, limited ourselves to 100% retail, and limited ourselves to say that we will service with the fees. We won't service with the fees, irrespective of seeing what competition does of zero fees or 5,000 rupees fees. We won't build deviation metrics within our system, saying that someone will come in and ask for deviation of rate of interest of fees. So we were very clearly focused on what we wanted to do. Somehow we were very clear that we wanted to be an ROE and ROA based company. We were very clear that we wanted to look at how the stakeholders will have a smile. We were very clear in how the employees will be have the smile when they get associated with Aspire. So clearly from an ecosystem perspective, when we built the company, it was important to talk to sponsors and get their engagement on the ESOP program at par for employees. That is what we got. For all the employees, mostly the denominator of the employees of the first year got ESOPs at par. And then there was a subsequent ESOP program that got also announced, again at the book value, because in the initial phase we don't have larger book value. So first ESOP was at 10 bucks, second ESOP was at 11 rupees, 45 paise. So clearly most of the employees of Aspire today qualify under the ESOP program of the company. So this is how the DNA and the concept of Aspire went in. Vis-a-vis many other HFCs who came along with us. So when I started my career 25 years back in the home finance segment, we were 3 home finance company in the country, 4 home finance company in the country. And when I approached an NHB regulator for license, Aspire got the 62nd license of, it became the 62nd home finance company. And yesterday I was in an Economic Times Summit in Delhi, and I'm told that it is 78 now, and Sriram Kalyan Raman, the MD of NHB, was telling that this will go up to close to 1995 by end of this fiscal year. So that's the kind of numbers that is coming into the home finance space and size. So we were the 62nd home finance company. Some of the numbers that we thought about, we wanted to script those numbers. We believed that we would not be a lender of last. We don't want to be a lender of last. And we don't want to be a first choice lender. So it's a very tricky thing as a practitioner to come out with a strategy as to, if you don't want to be a lender of last resort and if you don't want to be a lender of first choice, because both things have a very distinctive characteristics. As a lender of last resort, you price your risk. As a lender, as a first choice lender, you build your operational operations and customer segmentation in such that you have too much of cross-selling with each customer, and you don't make core business income, but you make income out of multiple other businesses. When you are a single product home finance company, unlike my friend who has multi-product and who can create ROEs from different verticals. So when you have a single product home finance, when you have only a business that you have to do, fortunately for us, as CEO, our focus only is on one single line of business. We don't have to deal with multiple, and that's what I was thinking, sitting at the back when gentleman was presenting that how possibly we are lucky enough to be focusing on a single product and getting possibly the same bonuses, hopefully, as we get into those lines of performance that we expect. So this was an interesting phase. The promoters and the sponsors' qualities and philosophy was also very, very critical in build up of the organization. So we were very lucky to have sponsors and promoters who were conservative, had capital to infuse. So we started with a 100 crores capital, which today after 27 months, and I keep telling in a very private conversation that in say 100 crore ko aaj humne abhi 405 crore kar diya. They have already invested 405 crores as capital, and there is an enabling resolution to further infuse 100 crores. So the promoter is going to infuse the first 500 crores in first 27 months of business operations. So whether it is a validation of some business processes, or whether it is a validation of what market opportunity provides, is still to come in, because in the lending it requires certain amount of seasoning and certain amount of time frame for ROE and ROA to get built up. But certain things went well with us. Within Aspire, certain things went very well with us, and I don't want to lose out modesty when I share this, because as young professionals and as people who are more researched in what all of you do, it's important to see us with a microscopic view and understand how we could build it up. So when we started our business, we were very clear that we'll be taking processing fees, which led us to generate some kind of fee in our balance sheet. We were also very clear that we will start selling multiple other products which are linked to the housing finance, which is property services product, which is life insurance product, both general life and medical product. So all four vertical put together would be an additional income to the balance sheet as we move on to our creation of balance sheet. We always wanted to build an PAT positive in the first year. So we got the license on June of 2014. That's where the journey of Aspire began. And when we received our license in June of 14, prior to license also, it was one of the interesting fact came out. And since that building of 12th floor had enough research people to tell us enough inputs on how and what happens in the start of an organization, it became imperative for me as a practitioner and as a CEO of a company to know that pre-operational expenses of an NBFC, HFC before the start of a company is typically in the range between 1.75 crores to 4 crores, which includes technology, people, processes, infrastructure, whatever you call it. So, पहले ही धंधा करने से पहले 3.5-4 crore का cost हो जाता है. That is what they carry forward to the balance sheet. Fortunately for us, we decided that we will build a pre-operational cost, and we targeted to maintain it at a 50 lakh level. And that is what the first success story of Aspire got built up. With an investment of 25 crores of capital, we put it in liquid funds with the help of all those people who could help us in investing, and we got some return, and our net loss in the first pre-operational period was 24 lakhs or 27 lakhs. So that is what the first success story of Aspire got built up. Coming on to the phase of operating, we wanted to build a PAT positive company, and your core businesses will not give that kind of PAT positive. So we went into all the insurance partners, we engaged with them, and the very first year, which was a 10-month fiscal year for us, we built a book of 367 crores and had a PAT of 2.17 crores in the first 10 months of our business operation. Largely covering income coming from insurance business and some of the income coming from setup cost that insurance company provided us. Otherwise, we would not have been a PAT positive company in the first 10 months. Then we got the full fiscal year last year, which was year 15-16. The previous year we funded 1800 crores of incremental lending, taking our loan book to 2000 crores by end of the fiscal year 15-16, with a PAT of 40 crores. Within that PAT also, it's important to mention that insurance fee income and third party fee income contributed close to around 60-70% of our PAT in terms of our growth. So that's how the first 10 months and the next 12 months passed. So 22 months passed, 22 months passed for the of Aspire, and we moved on to this fiscal year. We have scripted those numbers, and it would be unfair to say that we don't script numbers. We have to script numbers. So we scripted ourselves, and we said that on a given capital of 500 crores, on a gearing of 7 times, what is the kind of book we can look at, and what is the kind of geography and expansion, and what is the kind of yield that we should look at, affecting the philosophy of our lending. So clearly, we saw ourselves looking at a loan book of 5,000 crores by end of this fiscal year, taking our net worth close to around 650 crores with a capital of 500 crores, and that's what we probably would end this fiscal year as we close, and that will take us to 34 months of our business operation. So what next from here? From here, we continue to focus on what we are trying to do. We would require housing finance as a capital intensive business. Either we securitize, we sell down our asset if we don't want to raise capital. We have consciously as management decided that we would engage on enhancing our rating parameters. So it's also very important to share that when we started, the promoter of the sponsoring company was created by ICRA. We decided as an operating team to go to CRISIL and seek their rating review. We got an A stable rating from them as a first review. It got upgraded to A+. We again went back to them. In between, we also went to ICRA, and they also started with A stable, went up to A plus, and then upgraded to A AA-, as far as the rating of ICRA is concerned. As far as CRISIL is concerned, They rated us A+. We went back to them because it's not, as a practitioner, as a CEO, you don't like to be operating in a split rating philosophy, because you always get questions from all of you and many others as to why you have a split rating. Well, the philosophy and what you do is exactly what someone else has to look at it, but that's how the difference of rating philosophy is. So we went back, CRISIL decided to retain our rating of A+. So we appealed back to the appealing committee, because we believe that we are AA-, in line with what the market and expectations are. But our processes, our technology, our collection efficiencies have been built up, though the seasoning is still to be seen in the book, but the efficiencies have been built up in a way that we believe that it is. So the dialogue and engagement with CRISIL is still in. And we hope that either we will succeed in convincing them, or we will get convinced on being an A+ now and wait for an appropriate time to look for a AA-. But we believe that CRISIL as an institution is an engaging institution to go with, and hence we wanted to continue engaging with CRISIL. So that's been the story of Aspire for the last 27 months. We have. In our CMA that we represent, and before I conclude, something on the liability side on the housing finance, which is a very important machinery to run the housing finance. So two things I will share before I conclude, one on the people side and other on the liability machinery side. I think one of the biggest success stories for Aspire is on the liability side, in the way to build the liability. It was important for us to, while we engaged with the promoter and sponsor, they were very clear that neither the book is available for the operating team to leverage, nor their name is available for the operating team to leverage. So it's just the capital that you have for you to go to the bank and look for the gearing and leveraging. And we were lucky that as we speak today, we have 28 banks who have engaged with us, who have given us a letter of, who has given us sanctions, or we have drawn down from these 28 banks. We have, most of the mutual funds have also invested. So our liability program is 50% down loan from bank, close to around 35-40% from NCD, and 5-7% from commercial papers. That's a liability program that we run. We were also lucky enough to get IFC to fund us in the first 20 months of our business operation. We are also in talk with other multilateral agencies to get rupee denominator funds, because we are still not a 3-year-old company to get external commercial borrowings to come in. So that's the story of liability. I think the story of liability was something that differentiated Aspire from many other companies, because we looked at the successes or not so successful companies in the beginning, and we believe that liability machinery was very, very critical in the initial setup of any home finance company. Coming on to the most and very critical aspect of people, I think when we started Aspire, it was very, very important and very, very critical for us to understand that only it's a very highly domain-based industry. Fortunately, it's not a novice industry now, it's a 4-decade-old industry. It has produced great talent, it has great underwriting skills available in the market, it has overlapping businesses from banks, non-banking, and other HFCs. So we were very clear that we wanted most of our employees, most of our staff from Housing Finance Company. So as we speak today, we have 670 employees and close to 90% of them comes with housing finance background. We also believed on our business model. We went back to the conventional branch banking model. Gray hair वाले हैं उनको थोड़ा conventional branch banking model से बहुत लगाव है. We don't wanted to run businesses through DSA or discrete model. We always want to touch feel the customer. We want traffic to come to our branch, feel the customer and then lend to the customer, and that is what we do. People say that when you do that process, the scale is not possible. But when you are in a market where consumers just beat themselves, when they get a loan, they just beat and spread the message of being an ambassador of the company. You don't have to really have a DSA or an intermediary to pull or push your customers to come in. You have to build a good service delivery mechanism, and that's what we believe we are building in as we still continue to build it and invest in our technology and service delivery mechanism. So that's the story of Aspire. People have been a great strength for our team. Our attrition levels are lowest in the industry. While we have just early days, but we hope that we will continue to have that as we move forward. We only have one or two attrition in the last 27 months of establishing the company. So that's a small story of 27 months that we have built in. We have in our CMA document published to the bank, and we are forced to submit the CMA document of 10 years of our projection. In that projection, there is a reflection of a 750 crores of capital infusion in the company in this fiscal year. So people come back, you know how the banking environment works. When you send it to the corporate finance department, the CRM captures the 750 crores of capital infusion and then send it to the investment banking division, and they capture those information, and they come back and call you and say, we want the mandate because we are your preferred banker. So we haven't looked at any, we haven't given any mandate to anyone. We would be out in market looking for capital, either a follow-up capital from the sponsored promoter or capital from the outside market, and that's probably the first infusion of capital that will come in. We think we wanted to be an SDFC for Aman, which is the lower income thing. We certainly want to And I have no doubt standing here and saying that I want to cut pace the operation of STFC, and believe that if I can improve upon that, would invest in improving upon that, because that's the best operation that one could see. So we wanted to do that operations. We don't want to do the sales aggression of any other company. We have not built a sales organization. We built an operationally built organization, because home finance is a long term largest investment to an individual and a family. I missed out on one thing, and I'm sure it will come back as a question, but on delinquency and collection efficiency. Typically, when we look at a parameterized lending versus a non-parameterized lending, in a parameterized lending organization, you get an efficiency of around 98 to 99% on the date of collection, which means that if you have a 100 customer who has to pay installment on a particular month, every month, you typically get 98 customers paying the installment on the 10th or 4th or 5th, whatever the collection date is, through an electronic method or through salary reduction at source or any other such methods. In a non-parameterized company, it typically comes down to 88, 86, 89, 90. And that's where you have to build the efficiencies in putting up the right kind of ecosystem and DNA in the branch environment, so that your process of collection has a better efficiencies to manage. So as we speak, in the first year of 10 months, we had zero delinquency. In the next fiscal year of 12 months, we had 26 cases in NPA. As we speak now, we have 39 cases in NPA. But we believe that we will only continue to speak about number of cases in NPA rather than percentile, because percentile on denominator, growing company will have no meaning. So we believe that the myth that small ticket housing would have higher delinquency is early days to claim to fame, but can certainly say that if you have a great collection mechanism and you have a great, and when I say collection, it is not over the collection, it's something called receivable collection management. If you have a good receivable collection management, I guess you would have built up the similar efficiencies with a little backup of people to manage that's that receivable has come has what you see in the parameter spending. So that's brief. Any questions that I could respond and answer, more than happy to respond.
It's very fascinating that you started your business when, on one side, the real estate market had already started doing that, and on the other side, the
there is a lot of competition increasing. You know, as you have said, that there is a huge number of applicants and new entrants, and they have all become aggressive. So how have you, can you please talk about a little bit about the competitive environment, and how are you managing to grow, and what is it for each player? There are so many players, so suddenly everybody has found this to be a very attractive industry.
It's a very important question, and lastly, from the perspective, because we keep hearing about new entrants coming into housing finance, look at certain numbers, and most of the asset, all of you sitting here probably understand the first 11-12 slides. So usliye main wo pehla 12 slide ke bare mein bola hi nahi ki housing ka kya hai, GDP se kya hai, wo sab bola. But if you typically see what we are from a mortgage to GDP, we're close to 9.75-9% mortgage to GDP. Or the neighboring countries are like 11%, 12%, and the world countries are like 70%, 75%, 80%. The touch point of our market, I had an opportunity to also experience the US residential market space for 3 years when I was working over there in the US. Typically, US citizen just mortgages 16 times in the lifetime. And in India, while the statistics are very big today, we touched close to around 0.32 or 0.38 times for a mortgage. So, assumingly, even if we are able to touch point half of what the world market touch point in the next 15 years, we are talking about trillions and trillions of money that is required to establish the sector in its full way. So what are we as Aspire looking at? I would very clearly say that here there is a space for everyone in the competition to come in. Fortunately, and this is very interesting, if you look at what REPCO presented in the last earnings report, they said that the first branch of REPCO, which was created 16 years back, is still growing at 27% CAGR, which means that even that district of Adyar branch, which was the first branch of REPCO, still continues to grow. And same is the case with STFC. They established the first branch in Vashi Sector 17, and that branch is still growing at for over 20-25% CAGR in each of those cities. So that's how the market is, and that's how the demand of the market is. Certain dynamics of the market is also operating. Urbanization of the urban cities saw the nuclearization of family and this split in family. Now you see this split in family in the metro or non-metro location, and the urbanization split has given the kind of housing stock requirement in the top whatever 30-40 cities to create an STFC or create an LIC or create a GRU or many other companies in SBI or many other companies in banking. Perhaps the split in the non-metro or the villages of which is the advent of nuclearization in the family, or the early partition of property. Earlier, typically, karta of the family used to do the partition at the fag end of the life. Now, bachche pehle hi 30-35 saal ki umar mein bol dete hain, hamara hissa kar do, land mil gaya to construction. I'm sorry to be colloquial, but that's the reality of our life. And that increases the number of housing stock, because there is an element of own contribution that comes in the hands of the consumer as he grows. Otherwise, he has to wait for when his age reaches 45, 50, 55 to get that piece of land to construct that. So that's the economy of rural market or economy of taluk market is much different in terms of those segments. So I don't know whether I'm specifically answering your question, but is there a depth of market for another 10 players to come in? The answer is yes. Will there be a consolidation 10 years from now? The answer is yes, because that's how because the moment you see this private equity, and I don't know whether private equity colleagues of mine are sitting here, the moment you see this private equity people in the market and trying to chase down this company investing 5% here, 10% here, after some time they will all say that there is to some merge here. So I fear that, but clearly if I look at the growth for all of us in the industry, इट्स अ कैलकुलेटेड नंबर. एचडीएफसी ग्रुप 21 से 24% के बीच में कैगर तो उनका पिछले 20-25 साल से आ रहा है. सेम इज द केस विद एंड मोस्ट ऑफ द अदर प्लेयर्स आर ग्रोइंग एट 25-30%. मोस्ट ऑफ अस हैव एन आरओए ऑफ 2% प्लस. मोस्ट ऑफ अस हैव एन आरओए ऑफ 18% प्लस. Most of us have multiples of 3% plus minus few of them was led by wrong perception in the market. But clearly that's the business, that's the strength of the business. HFCs have grown over banks, though they don't have the geographical spread or the CASA support that they have. I think few policy level changes, which I'm part of the government committees, would perhaps make us into level playing field in the days to come. So उनको भी बनत लगती होगी तो हो सकता है कि more and more promoters are walking into this space as they see the opportunity coming in. But off late there is no regulatory arbitrage.
So you have mentioned that SDFC is the best. And operationally. So in the recent times it has not been able to grow that fast, and you know its growth is slowing down while I see all the new players are growing. So I don't understand, in terms of, so what you're saying about long term growth of the market,
on a 4 lakh crore 20% CAGR growth takes up to 80,000 crores of lending.
We all talk about 9% GDP, mortgage to GDP ratio. So long term growth is, 10-20 years we will grow, yes. But if you see, we are talking about last 3 years when you started. Market has suddenly seen so many players. The best operator, the biggest, is slowing down, is not able to grow as fast. So how did you find growth in that industry?
You can say is 20% growth of SDFC beyond expectations of the market. I think on a larger scale balance sheet, 20% growth with the kind of ROE and ROA is not a good growth. Expectations are very high. I believe it's a great good growth for one SDFC with that kind of large scale. It's a huge balance sheet, and there is only one SDFC, all others are smaller, so it's our percentile will look very very big in comparison to SDFC. But yes, there is an opportunity for creating another SDFC. But housing finance is not, see, I as a professional has never looked at it as my bonus for every year. So housing finance professional just can't look at every year balance sheet and say that yes, I'll get a bonus. One has to look for 5 year plus thought process in their mind to build a company. And you can't really build a company if you don't have a long term vision, especially if you're running a home plan. And I think there are a lot of great talent which has come out of home. And that's why more and more sponsors are investing on the talent and allowing new companies to come. So I'm one such individual who got sponsored by Motilal Ji and Amish. NBFC, banks, HFCs, all are different entities.
We are
classified HFCs, home finance company. When we started, we had a lot of regulatory arbitrage. We had 36(1)(8) benefit, we have long-term lending, we have priority sector lending benefit, and so on and so forth. There are certain benefits being a long-term lending player, but clearly some of those income tax benefit has been moved away. Today the regulatory arbitrage is not much, but clearly the asset class is very different. So when we operate on an asset class regulated by an independent regulatory environment, an agency called National Housing Bank, which makes us independent on the regulation, and that's what is building us separately.
But there's no advantage as you know.
So thank you very much, and
pleasure to you.